you just accept it, but something should happen there. And I've heard that there's weird tax issues with those properties. I don't really know, but, you know, it just seems like the core of our downtown is dead, and you guys should do something about it. Also, what's going on with the Sixth Street Marketplace? The last time I heard anything about that, Mayor Wilder was going to have some sort of study to look at what could go in there. You know, the Armory is a nice building. It's neglected. The windows are rotting. But it's a city-owned facility that we should be utilizing somehow. And I don't know what can be done, but something ought to be done. Thank you for the opportunity to come in.
Thank you, sir.
Respectful.
according to the present guidelines, that there was an issue with purchasing the trophies, that specific item, he reimbursed for $1,501. That was the amount. But he wanted, I believe, to have a discussion with the committee relative to the concerns with regard to the limitations of
$3.4 million that's uncollected as of June 30th. Most of the billings went out in the month of January of 2012. So that's about 36% of our billings are uncollected as of June 30th. There have been some collections since then, but it's not a whole lot better than that. If you look at the graphs on the next page, you can see that the collections were better in the first year, got slightly worse in the second year, and they're miserable, or getting miserable in the third year. And so part of the reason, or the main reason for that, is we are not allowed to do any collection activity, any traditional collection activities on the stormwater utility at this point. No, it was, that's what the administration has told us, and I don't know where it came from. You know, that's what our director was informed. We cannot do any late fees, we cannot do any calls, we cannot send to collection agencies, and we cannot lien properties.
I'm almost certainly going to misstate this, so if you can help me out, I'd really appreciate it. The stormwater utility fee was put in place to help the total daily wash load into the Chesapeake Bay with TDM something.
TDML, and I'm sorry, I'm not an engineer, so
that's what this was meant to.
Well, it's used, right? That, and it's also to help flooding. But primarily, you know, we are getting regulations from EPA and DEQ, et cetera, to control the nitrogen and phosphorus that's going into the river and
so
other.
Because of that, we put the stormwater utility fee in place.
Yes, sir.
What impact on non-collection does that have on our ability to do the things that the federal and state governments are mandating us to do?
It has a significant impact. I mean, we are now, if we could collect everything that we build, we would be able to maintain the existing system. We would not be able to, even with the current billing rates, be able to do the things that the federal government will be requiring us to do starting in fiscal year 15. So
we have limited time to figure out a way to make sure this money's coming in.
Well, this money, plus I'm afraid that there will, in order to meet what the federal government is telling us we need to do in fiscal year 15, we'll need to raise rates.
Or find another revenue source.
Or find another revenue source, yes, sir.
So,
that was my question. I just want to make sure that if we're not getting what we need in, what we can do to.
And I guess the question that I would ask you in this is, what is the reason why we cannot collect what we are billing? I mean, people not being, that's one thing. The fact that we can't take any action as it relates to that, I guess is the question that I want to understand.
I'm not the right person to answer that, ma'am. I don't know. We're doing what we've been told.
And you are being told this by
the administration.
Would I be correct in assuming that the administration is Mr. Marshall's office?
I would think that something like that would have to be directed at that level or above.
All right. Okay, just trying to. I'm sure there's a logical reason. If we are billing, based on the amount that we have billed versus the amount that we've collected, what's the variance?
The current year variance is 36.2% of its uncollected. Last year, there's still 21% uncollected, and from fiscal year 10, there's still 15% uncollected, and that's as of June 30. There have been some collections, but they won't make any measurable changes to these percentages.
Are these absence of collection, do they cover all of the classes, or are they limited to?
Yes, ma'am. If you see on this one chart, you'll see that it has multifamily residential, it has churches, nonprofits, and other non-residential, and it has
utilities, the department that handles this, these buildings and collection?
Yes, ma'am.
One other question. Yes, the question I would ask is related to maybe my colleagues. Anything important about the problem of utilities, we meet with them, have them to help us better understand this. And so, but I would like to make sure that there is no other standing committee that is dealing more specifically with this department. Ms. Ollie?
Do you mean with regard to the stormwater?
Yeah.
I do land, you know, land use was looking at that issue, but to what extent, I'm not sure.
All right, well, let's put this on the agenda for Department of Utilities to come in and give us better explanation as to the reason, what they are experiencing in this process, and what other efforts are being made as it relates to mediation, as well as building and collection.
Okay.
All right, Mr. Powell? Thank you.
Thank you. As I look at this, what I'm hearing you say right now is that basically 36% of the monies owed for this year have not been paid, and the biggest violations from the nonprofits in what's in our stand for?
Non-residential.
Yes, sir. Is that commercial?
That would be commercial, industrial, anything that's not a residential property other than those specifically.
If my memory serves me correct, when this ordinance was passed, it was my understanding that if the payments were not made, then liens would be placed on the property, so that when the sale of the property occurred, the lawyers that were involved with the transaction would know that this payment was due. And the question that I have is if you've been told not to do anything, how many transactions have occurred with these properties that we have no recourse now because those owners changed hands with the owners? I mean, we have, you know, monthly, you know, you look at the newspaper and you see all the property transfers. And so I think I would appreciate it if someone would begin to find out if in fact somebody has retracted this and has in fact put it in taken to the clerk's office or the clerk of the courts to properly record this information, or else we need to get this off the books, to be honest with the citizens of Richmond, that we didn't do our job, and that is making sure we're collecting the monies that are owed. I mean, it's obvious to me that if I don't pay this tax, if there's no consequences, then I think the rate is going to go up and it's going to get worse. And the issue at hand is, it was made very clear to council several years ago by Mr. Beschler that we can do it this way, or we can allow the federal government court system to step in and they'll do it their way. And we were very proactive, the administration and council was very proactive working to get this in place so that we were ahead of the curve as opposed to being behind. I really would like to find out where we are and with regards to procedures that are being handled. And I suggest that, Madam Chair, I would suggest that we have a follow-up at our next finance meeting on this particular issue. And thank you for the update on this. No problem.
Is there anything, thank you, Mr. Tyler. As so noted, we would like to have the Department of Utilities to come in and be able to address those concerns that have been raised. Department of Utilities is the one I understand is doing this, and I would hope that the administration would know what they
Not exactly, because you've had 3 years to collect the 2010 billings, you've had 2 years to collect the 2011, and you've only had 1 year to collect 2012.
Yes,
now, there have been some collections since June 30th, but as I mentioned earlier, they're very minor, and they may have changed this by a percent or two.
I think what would be helpful when you come back, if you could give us a snapshot, like as of October 1st for 2010, October 1st for 2011, and October, so for 2012, so that we could, or September when you pick the date, so that we have a kind of a good comparative analysis of the, same time frame.
Okay.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes, sir. Okay. So in other words, October of 2 years ago, October of 1 year ago, and this October for each one of the previous.
Because it may be. Yeah.
Well, we do this report quarterly and send it up, so, it's available.
Whatever quarter it works best, that way it may even 2 years ago, 2010, we had only collected $6 million at that, at that same time.
It would have been better than that. To your point earlier, yeah. When people find that no one's doing anything about collecting, they have a tendency of not paying themselves. So
all right.
We are seeing something.
We'll get enough. I think we'll have appropriate amount of time allocated over the agenda next month for discussion.
Yes, ma'am.
And if there are any other questions that committee members think of specifically that they would like to see answered, they can forward that information to Ms. Lualee, and she will take care of making sure it gets to the right persons. All right?
Yes, ma'am.
You have another report, sir?
Well, you have on your CIP, I don't have what you have as far as the, is that in the same document?
There was a request for a review of the
stormwater
fourth quarter report that was on the general funds as well.
That's revenue and expenditure.
Okay. Then I don't think I'm the right person for that.
All right, good.
Thank you.
Ms. Jenkins, are you doing just the review of the fourth quarter report that was sent? Do you understand that that's not an audit report? Members of the Finance Committee. I initially thought we weren't going to get a report, but as financial people, we need to always be ready. So we are ready. They're going to put in yes, that's it. While they're getting the it's going to be at a higher level, but we have all those documents in this report. So if you give me just 1 second. You have been in receipt of the preliminary fourth quarter report since I think August the 15th, is when we got that to you. What I'd like to do now is give you a high-level presentation on that report. So go to the next slide, Wayne. The numbers we indicate are preliminary numbers. The numbers you have are the numbers that were available as of August the 2nd. We consider these preliminary numbers because for most of our taxes, the revenues that are received in July and August are actually accrued back to the prior fiscal year. So any revenue received in July this year and August, we are accruing that back
to FY12. Also, on the expenditure side, it's basically the same thing. We look at the expenditures that are coming in and determine if they are appropriate to be approved back to FY12. And there may be some changes as a result of the external audit findings as a part of the CAFRA preparation, so hence you have preliminary numbers. We expect that the CAFRA will be completed and presented to you in late November. So here's a summary sheet, which is the same sheet that was in your packet. And it gives us the projected FY12 general fund revenue, $782 million, less the amount of our amended FY12 budget revenue, which was $715 million. And then, as you recall, the RMF payment came in. We posted that in fiscal year 12 at $62 million. And so we're projecting as of August the 2nd that our revenue surplus for the end of 12 would be around $4.1 million. On the expenditure side, we have, of course, a balanced budget. So expenditures were projected at $715 million, less any encumbered role, and of course the estimated risk management long-term disability. So we expected that our expenditures would be down by about $6.7 million. So if you looked at the decrease in the expenditures plus the surplus on the revenue side, we'd have about $10.9 million revenue surplus. Now we have to consider from that, if you recall when you approved the budget for 13, that you anticipated a $3 million savings from FY12. And you also assumed a pay-as-you-go vehicle for fleet vehicles. At the time that you approved the budget, you did not have the $5 million. We had appropriation of $5 million on the capital side, but you actually approved the $1.5 million. And then there was also the 1.5 to balance school. But what we have here, we show the $5 million that we project for fleet pay-as-you-go. Now I'm going to take these each of these categories and break them down just a little bit further for you. We have higher revenues because we anticipate higher collection of taxes. And we've listed certain taxes that are up. Our real estate taxes are up about 2.5%. And we documented here, here's the reason. When we initially developed the budget, the assessors assumed a decrease in valuation of property of about 5%, and it's actually coming in better than that, so it's 3.6. And then the public service corporation, we're getting additional revenues and tax size from that. And that is the utility companies, except the Virginia, the Dominion Virginia Power. So they include your gas companies, your pipeline companies. That's where that revenue comes from. We also see that our local sales tax are up, and we attribute that to an improvement in the economy. And then our vehicle rental tax is also up. So that's one of the large group for reasons for the revenue surplus. Another reason is some of the other. On the next slide, please. Some of the other taxes or fees are also up, and we list them there and try to help you to understand what is going on. You see the business license. You see some of our state revenue, other state revenue that we get, that's up. Our inspection fees, other sales, and payment that we receive to the general fund all contributed to the increase in revenue. Those were the drivers. In speaking to your staff, they had asked us for a presentation that gave any increase or decrease in revenue or expenditures plus or minus 25%. And we just put that in to show you that's what we presented to you. And we gave you comments as to why those areas would have been up or down. Next slide. On the expenditure side, what are some of the drivers that made the expenditures less than we had projected? There are about three or four. We've listed them there. A reduction in expenditure in the social services side. state took over the Medicare, I mean, the childcare and the daycare payment. And while there's a reduction in expenses, there's also a reduction on the revenue side for that. But that was one of the reasons. We have vacancies in various departments, and also the non-departmental savings was down. That's because we budgeted the 2011 bonus, but because most of the departments were able to take that out of their salary savings, we did not have to use that portion of the money in the non-departmental. And another reason was because the RAPIDS project, capital project, we had personnel that would typically have been assigned to the general fund in their department. They were working on the RAPIDS, and so their expenditures were charged back to the capital project. So that gave us a decrease in expenditures. So that's at a high level. What I can tell you is that we're continuing to monitor the revenues and the expenditure very closely now. And as we can see right now, there's trending to be more surplus revenue. We don't have the exact numbers, and of course we won't have it, but just to where it looks like it is as we're looking. And we're also trending down on the expenditure side. And I know that the mayor will have a conversation with you about those surplus revenues and how they will be expended or allocated or appropriated, either for streets, sidewalks, or employee benefits. I'm sure that discussion will take place, but that's what is happening now. And so that is at a high level. I have other documents that you have, and I can bring them up if you have any questions on any particular revenue source, stream, or in any of the departmental.
Revenue. state, but there's a $1.7 million difference between what the state has taken back and what we actually are saying we are saving. So the question I have is social services over budget? And if you need time to study that and figure that out, I understand. That's one question I have. Am I making sense?
Is social services at the end of the fiscal year, do we project them to be over budget?
Right, because what you've said is that you said revenues have been reduced because a program was eliminated.
And expenditures were reduced also.
And the expenditures were reduced, but it's not a one-for-one when you look at it.
Right.
And if it were one-for-one, I wouldn't ask the question because then it would be, you know, a wash.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not a wash. There's a $1.7 million difference, and I wonder what that is.
Yeah, so social services was also one of the departments that had additional salary savings from vacancies. So it's not, I pointed that out as to be the major factor in the expenditure.
That's not answering my question.
Okay, maybe I don't have your question exactly, but I'll
tell you what. I will try to rephrase it
here,
but I will rephrase it to you later.
Okay, all right.
I believe there is a difference.
Okay.
That budget is higher than what it should have been. The other question I had dealing with on the revenue side was delinquent real estate tax, delinquent personal property tax. We had projected almost $2.3 million more than what we received, and I was wondering if there's any thoughts on what happened there. I know we had an amnesty program that was very successful, and I can't remember if it was this year. Or
that was in 11.
That was in 11.
Yeah.
So what happened this year that pushed that revenue down?
The largest factor in that is that when the budget was adopted, we anticipated we would have the collection agencies on board. You may recall that you didn't approve for that actually to even happen until January of this fiscal year, which that meant 6 months had already passed. And then by the time they actually started to work based on several factors, it was actually June and July when we actually sent them the bills to work on. The companies had local offices, so they had to establish office, get people in the office. There were several factors that delayed us from getting the actual work for them to start collecting. So that is the major factor that we see there. They are now on board and fully working, and we've given them quite a bit of delinquent bills to work for us.
Okay. So we're anticipating a higher collection this year because of that, is what I'm hearing.
In 13, we're anticipating that it will be higher. We're back on board, we're giving them lots of deals to work, and they're working on currently.
The other question that I have with regards to this budget is finance. Finance shows that it was almost $1 million more above budget. In my question is, what is going on there that caused such a discrepancy? In the past, we haven't seen that.
You are correct, and I'll tell you two things. One, what actually caused it based on this data here was the fact that when we estimated our prior years, when we estimated our long-term liability, we estimated based on the prior year. We then subsequently had an actuarial study completed, and it was actually, we got a credit back. So when you see the final numbers, finance actually will not be over. We will actually have a surplus for the finance. So when we captured the numbers in August, it was based on the fact that we thought our liability payment was going to be much greater. In August, we had an actuarial study done, and it showed that we would be getting a credit back. But it was based on our long-term liability.
I don't know how finance department has a long-term liability.
Risk management is a part of...
Risk management, is that what it is?
Yes, it's a part of finance.
Okay, that helps, because I'm thinking of finance department, you know, people working desks, kind of things like that. And now with the risk management, that helps, because that tells me that's an outstanding potential liability. You don't know what it is until you get to a certain point.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you. And then the last one is non-departmental. You had a savings of you had a savings of $5 million there. And what actually created that?
The largest portion of that was, as I stated, when it was decided to give an employee bonus, it was going to be taken out of the non-departmental. It was posted for the non-departmental. As we went through the fiscal year, it was determined that the departments were actually able to cover that in their original budget, and so it did not have to be utilized from the non-departmental.
By any chance, do you remember what that bonus number would have been?
I think it would have been about $3.1 million.
Right, and it was 1% in my research.
Was it 1%? 1%.
All right, thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Madam Chair.
All right, with that, Madam Clerk, we'll go back to the paper from Mr. Jewell, additional financial reports. I think we have the reports that are before us. They are projected for the end of the year. So we look forward to doing an analysis of that in comparison with the capital.
Item number 4, resolution number 2012-R121. And that's to authorize 1501 from Council District Funds for the 5th District to pay for trophies for the 4th annual Ray Nevlett Inner City Basketball Camp.
Inasmuch as Mr. Jewell is not here to discuss this, my understanding is that he would most likely withdraw this, but I don't have a confirmation on that. So I would entertain a motion to continue this.
I'd make a motion to continue the board. Do we want to just continue it to the next city council meeting, or do we want to continue it for 30 days to this committee?
Let's continue for 30 days to this meeting, and if you withdraw between that time.
That makes sense. All right, I'll make a motion to continue 30 days.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Mr.
Tell
second. Thank you.
Do you want
to? Now,
this will be finalized, and we'll have our various there for us to talk about it a bit more. But the desire is that October 1st we'll have that list together, because after that we're hearing more about an additional time for counselors to get together to talk about the General Assembly session.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Madam President, do you have any comments that you'd like to make in regards to the retreat of the legislative agenda for this committee?
I guess my only comments that I would like to make, I just was in a meeting today, and one of the things, actually, is the regional planning, as we move forward with our legislative package, is probably going to be important that we just have one or two or three priorities that we want to move forward. The rest will be things that we support and don't support. The other thing is that I would like to get this done at that retreat so that we can begin to find legislators that will carry whatever issues there are that we wish to move forward.
And, okay, thank you. I guess the other thing that I would like to, for the committee to entertain, is whether or not we would like to have some more trees growing on the desk. There are several organizations that prepare a legislative agenda that have a tremendous impact on our agenda as well. The Planning Commission being one of those, VML puts out a very extensive legislative agenda. Virginia First Cities as well. Some of the things that I have asked to be put on the legislative agenda are some of the same items that these organizations are also either supporting or dealing with legislation. I think at a minimum, we should at least ask that the staff ask for and receive legislative agenda from at least those three. There may be others, and do analysis of those to determine if there are legislation within that package that either we need to be aware of, add to ours, or may want to consider as supporting some of those legislation that we may want to extend this as well.
And I would add to that, this, Madam Chair, Richmond Regional Planning is putting together a legislative package.
Yeah.
And one of the major issues on that package is going to be funding for transportation and roadway maintenance. So that's something that we will need to look at.
Okay, so let me make sure I'm clear, Madam Chair. You'd like us to, like you to contact VML, Virginia First City, Richmond Regional Planning, for us to get information on what they are going to be submitting in their legislative packet to see if there is any overlap or any, I guess, collaboration we can do with that.
Yes.
Okay.
And sometimes what happens, what I've experienced is that depending on the organization, some of their proposed legislation may be something that may not be in the best interest of cities, but it may work very well at other, from other perspectives. And that's fine if it's not negatively impacting funding. And I know that, especially with transportation and with the Regional Planning Commission's legislative agenda, there is plan for a proposed formula change that will make a tremendous difference as it relates to revenues that are coming to the city. And so I think that's why we want to at least look at those legislative agendas, and where there is reason, and perhaps Mr. amount of income that is used by the state of Virginia is significantly less than many other states. And because of that, a lot of benefits that we could be receiving federal dollars for, we don't receive because of that. And so there is a broader description of what those formulas are and what is the recommendation that is being presented to increase that threshold that you're using for eligibility for the state.
So what happens is that this would be something we would have to have our other localities join in with us to get the state to get to the right formula.
Yes, it would have to be, and like most things that goes before the General Assembly, we would have to have other localities to work along with us. This is something that that has been in discussion, and so it will not be a new item to the General Assembly. Ms. Ali?
And also, just to follow up, what we're trying to do as staff is to basically follow what Mr. Tyler, this formula that he just asked, relative to that TANF issue, to try to have task staff with coming up with a little blurb so that you will know what the patron, well, what the requester is asking relative to that specific item. So in the next list that you see, hopefully you'll have more information rather than, say, for example, number 13, work quality funding. What about that issue is the requester seeking?
So you're going to, it sounds like I'm hearing you're going to get more detail.
Yes.
Because I mean, you know, transparency.
Yes.
Transient occupancy tax, I'd like to have more information on that. And the same thing with internet retail sales. I think Mr. Hilbert and I, we're one of the same on the conversation. He referenced a Style Weekly article about the use of the city, and I talked about the pilot program, mm-hmm. or the pilot tax. And, so,
as I mentioned, ideally, at least by that retreat, you will have a more complete list of items, at least more information on the items.
And this, I know Ms. Robinson put in water quality funding, so perhaps you know, that paragraph could help us there too.
And just I have one getting into that revenue expand fees for Blighted event panhandling business legislation. We need to have full explanation on that.
We should expect a call
Thank you.